All right, you may be seated. Hallelujah. Greetings to all of you that have joined us on the live broadcast. Wherever you have joined us from the states here in the United States of demonic power, that's what it is. And those that are scattered, and wherever you're listening in other parts of the earth, we greet you all, Yahshua's mighty name. For this is Yom Shabbat. This is the day that Yah has bara, he has created. And in the knowledge of that, then we should be exceedingly glad. Lushimcha, the great rejoicing of Almighty Yah that is revealed in the power of the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. And if the testimony is not real of great essence and power, then we simply don't give a damn. We're not going to rejoice and be exceedingly glad. But because the testimony is of great essence and substance of his power, then there should be no motivating external things that cause us to rejoice. We offer up unto him the free will offering. We do it because we delight in doing that, Yisrael. That's why the praises should continuously flow from the lips of Yisrael. That's why he commands us, irregardless to how the circumstances look, in all things, in call everything, we give to Yah, we give Yah unto Yah, and it is a thanksgiving of praises that you know how sincere he is, because you have shown him the same benevolence that he has showered down upon you. And if we are not real Yisrael, then frankly, we just do not give a damn, and there will be no excellence of praises of our voices to exude, to esteem, to lift him up for all of his excellence. I wanted to sing the song this morning as I was thinking, I am simply glad to be alive, to have the heart, the life, the substance of life in me on this Shabbat, as we can see the rage of the tornadoes and the strong winds that are blowing upon this nation. The havoc that is reaping upon the communities and their wealth, their substance. It is wreaking havoc. And there are those that are dying in the midst of it. They try to get out of the way and they cannot get out of the way. We're just seeing the beginning of the great sorrows that shall embark upon all the nations, Yisrael. It's a time of great sorrows. And when the winds of his earth, the storms, the whirlwinds, y'all say, when the whirlwinds come upon you as shemama, as desolation, you say, you shall be gone to seek me, but you shall not find me. Y'all said, you will not adhere to sound doctrine, to my wisdom. And in the midst of all of your agony of calamity, you shall be gone to seek me. You will cry out, but then I will mock you. I will laugh. I will deride you. So the day that he presents unto us like this, we need to train ourselves. These are, and this is the training ground for Yah. If we do not gather, we will become very lackadaisical. If we don't constantly remind ourselves to come into the bayah to pray, we will not pray. We will stop praying. And if we do not gather on this Shabbat to offer up unto him a resounding sound of Todah unto him, we will stop doing it, Yisrael. That's why we don't forsake the assembling of Yisrael, the gathering in these times. Because you will find yourself moving a little farther away, a little farther away, a little farther away. And then you will find yourself, you're not even convicted. There's no praises in your lips or your mouth. You will not esteem and extol him with this excellence. So we must be constantly reminded. There must be a constant reminder. We must remember. Zachar. It must be embedded in our minds. And the only way we remember her is that it must be imprinted. It must be a constant action of that in order to remember. Because our memory is not long. We forget what he did to us yesterday and for us. Every second of the day, when there was someone dying every 8 seconds, they say, I will debate that all day. I believe every second of the hour or the minute someone passes from this realm. And every second or two, someone is born. Death and life, it is a constant cycle in this way. So let us die out to our flesh, kill it. No, hell no, you don't crucify it. You impel it. You destroy it. You destroy the elements of it. You destroy it. You destroy not only the affections of the flesh and the spirit that drives us, we must impel that and destroy, because if we don't, we're going to find ourselves in some sad shape. And we are in bad shape anyway. We are a nation that is spiritually unhealthy. We are people that's mentally unhealthy. We are people that's physically unhealthy. We are in sad shape. That's a fact. Beloved, I desire, I would above all things, that you may prosper. The sure hath. You may acquire all the riches of your prosper and be in top excellence, Rafa, even as our nefesh, even as our lives, even as the wholeness of our beings prosper, then we should be in the excellence of the spiritual health of Almighty Yah. And we are sick, we're sickly, we're dying, there's no motivation for Yah. The nation of Yisrael, Yah, is not inspired by Yah. We've been fed all kinds of dogma, lies, deception. That's poisoning the mind of Yisrael, Yah. We're people that's very easily deceived. This is a generation that boasts that no man deceived me. They are damn liars. You're deceived all the time. Never forget, my natural brother said to me, baby boy. He will call me that, baby boy. Don't be a pancake. Don't flip and flop, flip and flop. And I've never forgotten that. If you've ever given me a wise counsel, it was wise, baby boy. Don't be a pancake. Don't flip and flop. You simply stand with truth. In your ignorance, as he has done in all of my life, he will bring you to the knowledge of that truth and open up the wellspring of that wisdom, and it shall flow in the depths of your bosom. So we rejoice. Hallelujah. This is Yah's day. Hallelujah. And the Shabbat is an oath. It is a sign between Yisrael and his people. Yah and Yisrael. They say that they love Yah, do not keep the Shabbat. They are damn liars. This is an oath between his nation, his people, that they regard HaShabbat. They zachar, remember the Shabbat. And it makes no difference who it is. I'm going to preach today, hallelujah. I was looking at this article in the paper this morning, two pictures that my Zachin Shimri, he has so kindly over the years granted that I can get the paper on Shabbat. He has it coming to his home on the Shabbat. I thought this was a very beautiful picture here of Mrs. Barack Hussein Obama, Miss Michelle Obama. I think she's a very attractive woman. I do. You know, here people, they don't give a damn about Barack Hussein, but they really like her. They really do. It's not the picture. I just saw the very, can you see those young women, the expression on their faces to be able to tenderly press themselves against her? I think the woman has a very beautiful spirit, I really do. And not only that, that's not the focus of what I wanted to show you, is this that has gone what they call viral. This is a damn filthy nation. Yah's gonna tear this whore down to the gates of hell. He's gonna rip her up. You're trying to pray that he save it. and save those that love it. You are full of deceit. I don't give a damn if it's your children, your mother, your sons, and your daughters. This is one of the most vilest, and they put this in the paper for your sons and your daughters to see. It is one of the most vilest. I saw it the other day, that these two damn corrupt beasts, that this man coming back from Iraq has his legs wrapped around another man, and they're giving this what they will call a romantic kiss. It has gone viral throughout the nations of the earth. Now, this is what this vile, ignorant nation purports. This kind of the most vilest of filth that has been conjured out of the gates of hell, out of the belly of Hashatan. When men embrace men and women with women, with dogs and beasts, Yah's gonna cause his earth, his resentment that is expressed in his nostrils. That is what his earth is. It is a keen resentment. It is a hatred that his nostrils shall turn up. He say, this damn vile people that despise me, they have made destitute of the truth. Your children in the generations, if there are, and if there is another generation, they will not even know what's right from wrong. 70% of this nation says it's all right for men to marry men and women with women. You will not hear the serpents of hell who are employed by the powers of darkness, the Baptist whorehouse, the Methodist whorehouse, the Islamic whorehouses, the Jewish whorehouses, the false Hebrew whorehouses, the Church of God whorehouses. You will not hear them rise up against this vile repugnance, what they call a lifestyle that denies the very power of Almighty Yah. They are sick and wicked. They are unclean children of Hashatan. They do everything that is filthy. They drink from his nidah, from the cup that is most vile and most abominable. And because of our rejection, Yisrael, of the Torah of Yah, we have no power to set anything in order. Because we are not the true Shafat, the true judges. And it must be done in our own corrupt damn conscience. We don't judge ourselves righteously. That's why we have no power, ability to judge no one else. We don't judge matters that arise between us. That's why Yah set Moshe. Yethro said to him, you're going to kill yourself. Set men of 1,000, of 100, of 50, of 10. Set them as governors of the people and the most extreme matters. Let them come to you. And he laid his hand on all of the Zachin, or the Zachin. He laid his hands on all of them. And they were imparted with the same Ruach as he. You find a Zachin that doesn't judge. He is not even a fledgling weak thing. He is a wicked thing. I will, man. You find one having not the strength to set the order of Yah aright. And it begins in his own personality, his own character. Because if he cannot set his own heart aright, how in the hell does he set the matter of Yah aright? He must orchestrate in the rule of Yah well. He's the minister of the justice of Yah. That doesn't exclude a man because he is not addressed as a Zachin. This young man is a Zachin. He is the elder of his home. If he does not set it right and in order, is because there is something lacking in him. And there will always be the opposition of the spirit of what Yah calls the Ishua. That's why he deals with her according to knowledge, knowing that she possessed not the strength of the Ish. And this woman possessed not the strength of Yahshua HaMashiach, but he has granted all things unto us, just like the Zachin grants unto his Isha. When he leaves, the children are in subjection and rule under the same authority because he is her head. And she is the head of them. We are an ignorant people. We have been taught lies and we love lies. We don't want the truth, Yisra'el. We love lies. We love falsism. We must deal with truth. I'm going to teach you today, and I know what I'm going to teach on. I want to read this article. These are the individuals, you'll be surprised, the mentality of those that are in leadership positions, how they think, what they think of people, their concept. This is from the chief head federal judge of the Midwest. I want to read this. He says, his name is Richard Siebel. Richard Siebel. Richard Siebel, he is Montana's chief federal judge. He is the chief federal judge. He sits as one that, even though the federal judges, he is the one that has the power to make final resolution. He is over all the federal judges that are appointed by the President of the United States. He makes that appointment. Just like generals, the president, he makes the appointment or promotes. Anything beyond that, it is done by the Congress and state Congress. But this is the attitude of Mr. Siebel. He says, Richard Siebel, Montana's chief federal judge, apologized. This is my injection. It is false. To President Obama, after admitting that he forwarded an email, listen, comparing African Americans to dogs, and implied that President Barack Hussein Obama, his mother had sex with a dog, with animals. I sincerely and profoundly apologize to you, you and your family, for the email I forwarded, and Siebel's apology letter, which was dated March 1st. I accept full responsibility and no one to blame but myself. Honestly, I don't know what else I can do, Siebel says. This is the man that compares a people that he believes that's African Americans. They're no more than a damn dog, a beast. You'll be surprised at the mentality of that that permeates a wicked, dirty nation like this nation. He says that the email was racist, but I am not racist. You know what comes out of the mouth of those that are vile? The next thing, he didn't say it. I have wonderful African Americans or black friends. They always say that. When you hear that, you know they're racist bastards. They're dogs. This nation is predicated upon racism. It is inbred in the minds of their siblings to be racist. That's why they call themselves whites. You can look at any genetics of DNA construct, you will never find a white race. It is a socially made up word that fits a society of people that believe that they are superior to every people, every nation, every culture, every principle. And if you truly look at the nations like Britain, England, Greece, show me any culture, America, that has had any impact on the world. Please show me. The modern day technology, it's frying your damn brains. The ability to process food, to keep it for years, we are sick as hell. Sodium, carcinogenous in the cans that you eat the food from. We are sick. We are a belligerent people. Very little life in us. The nations of the earth. So show me one thing that America has given us, except Elvis Presley, that learned his wares by going down in the midst of the forbidden community, whereby they were gathering their little juke joints, and he will watch them shake their buttocks and dance and sing. Tell me. They've given us computers, it's killing you. Given us the internet, you have no time for y'all because you are interwoven into a damn net that shaped your mind. They've given you television, it is the most profound media to corrupt you. Show me. So you think that this man doesn't consider that those he called African Americans are not dogs? You think that he has a just judgment in his sentences toward those that are not of his pigmentation of the color skin? And we cannot just let that ride and say, oh, well, it is just a minute case. This is the mindset. It is the nature. It is the reality of what a people must battle every damn day. They must be constantly reminded of that. And so Hashaltan always let his children know, remind them who they are. He said, the man and the people of the diaspora, you equate them with dogs. This is a man, undoubtedly, he understands constitutional law. You must understand, Yisraya, that the Constitution did not incorporate those of the diaspora into what is a man, those that have the unalienable rights to create happiness, that they are free. We can see it in many of the cases, law cases, Dred Scott in Missouri. When there was a free territory that his master took him to, he should have been free. And yet Mr. Tenney, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, said, quote, that he is still the property of his master, because the Constitution does not give property, one that is of the diaspora, any rights at all. So through the years we have had amendments to the Constitution. We can look at it any way we want to and try to say that it is not of a reality, but it is. The arcane laws on the books that this wicked society still use, the law ring, the jaywalking, because those men are the diaspora in the South. That's why that they began to balkanize and to create what we call districts. That's why they began to do that. A senator from Georgia, his name was gerrymandered, and they are gerrymandering. They create districts. So to break up the population of strength, because from the South, the men of the diaspora would have overtaken Congress. And that was not going to be. And that's why they had poll taxes upon those of the diasporas that they had to pay to vote. That's why they had literacy tests to see if they were able to read. Yet no other nation. That's why 66, the Voting Rights Act, that has to be amended every so many years, because those of the diaspora they have no right to vote. Your baby in your arm has no right to vote. And a nation says liberty, freedom, and justice for all. It is a damn lie. It is a damn lie. It is a damn lie, and every man should speak out against that. You should not cover that in your bosom. It is a damn wicked nation. But it's one thing that I'm glad of. The master, he's got it all in control. That's all right. He's got it all in control. He is the one that is orchestrating and controlling every aspect that is trespassing in the earth. And he has said unto them, let the enemy reap or coals upon their heads, for out of the gates of hell they shall cry, and there shall be no mercy for them. You show no mercy upon a people, Yahweh show no mercy upon you. That's why he is still angry with Esav, because in the midst of Yisrael, all of her battles, and Yehuda, Esa, the Edomites would laugh and mock. Yah says your dirty house is coming down. What you have shown them, I will put it on you. And he doesn't lie. And what he says is truth. And it's coming to pass. It is the senility of a generation that is so depraved. Their minds are not cognate of Yah. This is the purveyor, the faucet of death out of this wicked nation. It is a nation that every kind of nida for her cup, is in the hand of this wicked nation. She is the mother of every kind of vile crop. Abomination, her balances, her scales are crooked. I was reading yesterday in the large metroplex in the large cities like Atlanta, Detroit, Baltimore. You literally can buy a house for $500. And some of these large conglomerates, the banks, they're buying them up by the hundreds of millions. They're saying to that little poor individual that cannot pay taxes, get out. They repossess. They board it up. That week is sold probably for $500,000, $600,000. And they are purchasing this greedy mentality, this spirit of the wicked one, and send to those same individuals that have paid for their homes five times over, you rent it from me. Yah is going to bring the hand of his mavith. This nation is already dead. It has died prematurely. And you, Yisrael, you cannot be caught up in this spring of death. You better come out of her. You better not touch her unclean things and not allow her philosophies and her ways to impregnate your mind that you began to believe in it. You began to act that way. You better free yourself from this wicked nation. The concepts, the desires, the passion for us all coming to naught is coming down, as the old one was saying, Hashatan, your kingdom is coming down. Oh, devil, your kingdom is coming down. You have been building your kingdom all over this land. But oh devil, oh devil, your kingdom is coming down, it's coming down. It's coming down. Yah has given this beast of hell season that he may go and mark his children. We're in the time of the mark, Yisrael. We need the tav of Yah. We need the sure sign and the sure markings of Yah in our leba and our right hand. We must understand, even as we go back to the tasnith, and that is that which is of the pattern, that is the construct, that is the validity, the shape, the form of what it should be. We must go back to the tasnith to understand what the construct and the value and the importance of the uth or the mark in the right hand. Why the leba and the right hand? We're going to get into the depths of that. I am not going to finish it today, next Shabbat, or the following one. But what I want to do today is to whet our desire, our passion to hear, to learn. A burning desire to know what Yah wants to speak unto his nation, Yisrael. We know that this one that sits arrayed in her most precious garment, and there is no nation that is arrayed in wealth like this nation. There's no nation. There's no power on the earth that seduces every nation and commands them to be subjugated without them willing unto her laws, her restraints, her compassion, her desires, that she may slither in like a beast, like Hashatan with Hava, and began to sow the vileness of his poison in her mind, that this nation sows poison and death into every nation, and that the people become very sumptuous, that is simply greedy and lustful. They're not satisfied with the simplicity of their lifestyle. They began to see what they think is the grandeur of a lifestyle. And they began to forget even simple principles that had fed their forefathers and fed their families and kept their communities afloat. And there was a great interaction, regard, a concern and care for each other. I seen that when I went to Kenya, the poorest of the poor. Their hearts were open. Those that had nothing were willing to share. Those were poor, they didn't steal or take from each other. They didn't rob. They did not defile another man's daughter or another man's, his household or his wife. Oh, I'm not saying that that was not there in the midst, but it was not the pervasive power in the midst of that people. And these are those that the world will call heathens. Yet they had principles that were greater than those that called themselves Christians and Hebrews and Israelites and Jews and Muslims. Just on the culture and the foundation of their cultural upbringing, their principles were more in line with Torah than those that say that they love Yah. And so this nation, she is the cauldron. She is this vase filled with every kind of nida, every kind of filthy thing. It corrupts our minds. It corrupts our hearts. And we began to sell ourselves for nothing. That is vital to understand. We have no bichor, we have no birthrights. This whole nation here of a people, there is no birthright. I do not give a damn if it's the Native Americans, those that came from Britain, from England, from all over the world, they have no birthright at all. Those are the diasporas. And he calls them, he's going to call the nations. to receive the oath, the allegiance, their minds will be in legion with the powers of hell. They will operate out of the nature of HaShatan. That is why it's so easy for us to lie. So easy for us to intrigue one another wrongly without conscience of how we have intrigued our Ach or our Ahot. That's why it's so easily for us to segregate ourselves from one another. There's no conscience of that. That's why it's so easy for us not to give a damn about one another. This is how all men will know that you are my disciplined ones. Because of the greater harm you have one toward another. The way you love Yisrael. The way you care for Yisrael. A heart that has great passion for them. And we frankly do not give a damn. It is the throne of darkness, Yisrael. It is the seat of hell. We're not passionate for Torah. I'm talking to you, my friend. We're not passionate for Torah. We're not passionate for truth. And of course, we are above any kind of musa, any kind of counsel to discipline us, to correct us. I've never seen such silly, stupid generation. And I haven't been around that long. I was brought up, even in the natural way, when someone that you perceive that was wiser than you, you listen. You don't reject. You don't have disdain because you have elevated yourself. You don't have a damn thing. You may think you do, but you really don't. You have no substance because it's one thing that Yah commands us to mark, to tithe, a perfect man. For the end of that man is shalom. You mark him. That simply means you shema, you watch him. You watch his walk, his actions, his deeds, his conversation. For at the end of the day, at the end of your conversation with that man, whether he corrects you, whether he admonishes you, whether he rebukes you, the end of that brings shalom to you. So we are a silly generation. We're foolish. We have no heart for Yah. We have a heart for sin, but not for Yah. I want to continue. In this teaching, I do pray that Yah grants unto us wisdom, understanding, that we may understand this desolation, this devastation that shall come upon the nation, this Bada, this Duma, this Harab, great devastation, not just upon the nations and the land, but great devastation in our own lives. We must understand. I want to begin here, Yisrael, in the book of Gilyan or Revelation. I want to identify and to bring some kind of clarity to this behemoth, this beast, or the mark of beasts and the mark of man, the oath, the allegiance. This is a mind that has no concept of Yah. It is a mind that is against Yah. It is a mind that has the greatest contempt. It despises, it hates truth with a passion. And Yahkahan, one that Yah had ordained to stand before his presence, he has not ordained that for every man to stand and to receive revelation. He was one of the few. And what we do, we garner from that revelation by the power of the Ruach HaKodesh that is in us. Not by our folly, not by our ignorance and our stupidity. We sincerely need the Ruach HaKodesh of Almighty Yah. We need that. It is vital. We have sold out the birth and the power of Yah for nothing. For our emotions, our feelings, our wicked nature, we'll sell him out. And we think that this has no relevance in our lives. We just don't know Yisrael. He shall cause many, the spirit that is pervasive. It is prevailing against us. That's not so. You are a damn liar. I will show you what, as I'm always reminded, as Bishop Bates would say, what the book says. I'll read it from the book. Let us see what the book says. So here in the book of Gilead, now Revelation chapter 13, I don't want to begin in verse 6. As we began with the task needs, we must understand the pattern, and we will get to that. I want to lay out the latter end, that we can go back to the better sheet and see that to this point, Israel. If you listen to the story of Jean Valjean, he always starts with the end, and then he goes back and fill everything in. You're sure he is the first? And he is the last. So it makes no difference where you began. You got to deal with him first. And you got to deal with him last. Makes no difference where you start, Yisrael. And so as he was in this profound vision, as Yah began to open up the wisdom unto Yahanan, he showed him that which was so profound, as he saw this one rise up from out of the masses of the people. He saw the very power of Hashatan, the very identity, his character, his personality, rise up from among the nations of the earth. And it says here in Revelation chapter 13, verse 6, this is the nature of that one whose mind is depraved, that has no love for Yah. It says here, and he, the dragon, Hashatan, his nature, he opened his fifth, his mouth, his language. He opened his mouth to Nihara, to blaspheme. Blaspheme what? To speak with contempt, to despise. What I want to do is define the word contempt in your English vernacular. The word contempt. It is simply the act of despising or the state of the mind of one who hates or despises. That's what contempt is. It is the state of one's mind. It is the constant reminder that I hate this one, that I despise them. I despise that. It is a state of mind that is of constant despise. It is a feeling with which one regards something that is extreme low. It is the feeling, it's the regard that one looks at this and says, it has no relevance in my life, and esteems it with despicable despising. It's low, it has no relevance. They consider it as something that is vile and it is worthless. Yah says we should not take his name in shav. It should not be a worthless and a vile name. But the very nature and the very mind of this mark, this uth, this allegiance with hell, this depraved, perverted mind that cannot respond to the commands of Yah, because it is not nurtured by the Torah of Yah. It is nurtured by the one that opposes Yah in everything. He must take preeminence, he must take power, and he must govern from one's mind. And once he began to govern, they must sell one of the most important, one of the most valuable things that they owned. Do you think you know what it is? You will find out. They must sell it. It is a mind that causes one to sell and not buy the truth of Almighty Yah. This one, this dragon, this behemoth, he opened his mouth in blasphemy with contempt against Almighty Yahweh. He opened his mouth with contempt. You find those that open their mouths with contempt against Yah. There's a vile nature to that individual. I don't give a damn if it's your husband, your wife, your children, your sons, your daughters. But he opened his mouth with contempt against Yah. For what purpose? To blaspheme his name. His dwelling place and them that dwell in her Shemaim. He opened his mouth with blasphemy to speak vile and with an indignant way against Yah. Because you must understand, he is the Christ. He is the anointed one. The word Christo, Christ, Christine, it simply means the anointed or the anointed one. Yeshua is the one that has the oil of Yah poured upon him without measure. So anyone can be anointed, Yisrael. Anyone can be anointed. Anyone can be a Christ or a Savior or one that comes. Yeshua is our Yeshua. He is our kinsman redeemer. We don't have a damned savior. We offer up a sweet smell and fragrance unto Yah, but we don't have a damned God savior. It is the praises of Yisrael, the purity of the hearts that offer up the fragrance before the throne of Yah. His first and most powerful construct is to cause man, those that are under the rule of his government, to blaspheme, to speak vile against the name. I would rather shut my damn mouth if I did know. I will not say a thing, and you all taught me that as a young, ignorant man. I would hear things, I would not try to debate it. I would not try to speak on things that I had not thoroughly engaged myself in to understand the depth and the riches of it. You have a generation that may hear a thing. They have not labored in the Torah to understand the depths and the might of the matter. And they began to speak as though they have wisdom of the matter. I was speaking to my Akshimri this week. I don't boast in things. And there was one that called me. You heard me say it last night. From California, he says to me, I've been listening to the broadcast. The messages day and night. And I'm in the Church of God of Israel. He said, but when I listen to this, although we have teachers that show us things in the book, he said, one of the first things that I comprehended about this man, he said, I knew he was a man that labored and studied in the Torah. I had a young man to call me yesterday from Denver, Colorado. Those were the same words or the same inspiration to me. And I said to him, my friend, you call, and I have been in the Torah all morning trying to write a booklet or to post some things that are viral unto Yisrael. She doesn't understand when she comes in making noise. I said to her, I wish I had me a little building that was off, that I can sit in there and just stay there. When I get it done, I will come into the house. You understand? Because you are a distraction. And you distract my concentration for what things that I must understand. We must have those that understand. You can't sit on your ass and lay back and don't do a damn thing. And not desire to know and to understand. You must labor and lahak, study, that you will always bring a word of great profoundness and refreshness unto Yisrael. You must always do that. He said, this spirit, this one that rose up, he began to blaspheme the name of Almighty Yah. He began not only to blaspheme his name, but he blasphemed the name of his dwelling place. He has put his name in his beit, in the tabernacle. And also them that dwell, those that go, those that are the inhabitants of the kingdoms of Yah, of his kingdom. And Yah says here in verse 7, and it was given to him. The power was not found bestowed upon him. It was given to him to make war with the Yisraelites, Jerusalem, the elect, the Bohir. It was granted unto him to have war with them. And this is profound. He was granted the power to Yahkul, to overcome. He was granted the ability, the power, the strength to persuade, to subdue, and to overpower. That's what Yahkul is. You can define it any way you want to, but he was granted that to overcome. That's why we must be assured that our names are written in the Lamb's book of life. We must have, and they overcame him by the power of their testimony, of the testimony of the dime of Yahshua HaMashiach. And they love not their lives unto the death. He shall rise up with them that keeps the mitzvah of Yah, that keeps Shema, that guards his commandments, his Torah. You're not going to overcome. Yah gave him power to overcome. He gave him the ability, the Yahola, to overcome the Yisraelite Jerusalem. It says to overcome them, and power was given to him, not over some, but called over all kindreds. Not even over all kindreds, but all languages, tongues, and speech, and all nations as well. There is no exception at all. And this vile spirit today, which one bears the oath in their Mesach, they have extended the hand of their strength, and you will understand what that is as we go. That they had received the mark of Hashotzan, and the mark of man, his one that he shall send forth. He is anti-Hamashiach. His words are against the name of Yah, because you cannot have a Yoshuach without Almighty Yah. So this vile one has produced those idols and gods to support even Yahshua HaMashiach. Names that are so vile and corrupt have been created out of the minds of devious men to supplant the name of Yahshua. Yah gave his son a name. He has a name. He has a name before there was before. He was, he is. And he is all that shall be. Yahshua is the first. He was there when there was no being there. He is the word of Yah. He is unexplainable in the mind of man. You can't grasp it, just like man cannot grasp the depth of the universe and the spheres of this created thing they call the universe, the galaxy, the solar systems. They can't understand that. It began their reach even to see to the depths of it. I can start out of a journey from here to California. Eventually I will get there. And man, through the years of his time, he has never been able to reach. He has never been able to reach even to the first realm of the Dorset of Yah. Even with the mind of Nimrod. As he thought he would exalt himself and establish him a name in the earth. It is Yah that gives us a name. It is Yah that bestows greatness upon a name, a nation, a people. It's not the proudness of military power. It's Yah that grants that. Yah says, I'm going to grant him power to overcome to Yahul, the Yisraelite Kurushim. Does it say that in your writings? He may use the word saints. But he was given power to overcome to Yahul. He had power, strength, ability. This has been granted from Almighty Yah. He was able to gain the threshold And above all that, he is able to accomplish what Yah has granted unto him for the time and the season. This is the prelude of what is. We see it in the spiritual realm. We see it in the mind, the nature of man today. We see it in our own actions, our own activities. We can see that. There is no rejoicing when we hear the name of Yah. It is not sweet to our ears. There is no great love for Torah. There is no power of his presence among Yisrael. We're not driven, as David said, when they opened the house of Yah's assembly, I was glad. We don't give a damn how we come before the presence of Yah. We don't give a damn if we don't offer up unto him the Botach. We don't give a damn. We do not present ourselves kadosh unto him. We really don't give a damn, Yisrael. There's no excitement when it comes to Yah. We're excited about Walmart, Kmart, Dollar Mart, Cloth Mart. But we don't give a damn about Yah. You're excited about everything but him. We get excited about truth. We don't get excited about hearing the voice of Yeshua. The shofar blowing. Because his attributes, his name, they are the lowest contempt of esteeming among us. We use it for expedience, Israel, but there is no reverence for his name. When I think about that name, in all the tov and the mercies of Yah, in that name, my nefeshat, hallelujah, I berach Yafa Yeshua, Hamashiach. We don't respond that way. Through the most powerful essentials that Yah grants unto Yisrael, I'm not going to ask us do we know what they are, because we really don't know. And those that are listening do not know. We must be taught. We must have teachers among us. They must be precise and diligent. They must drive to understand. We cannot putter along. Even when in school I loved a teacher that was demanding and challenged me. We must be able to lehag. We must be those that are able to teach. We must have the ruach of the mure. That's why you zachin must teach. You elderly isha, you elderly zachin must teach and show. He had power to overcome. And this is the crux of the whole matter in verse 8. And all that dwell upon the earth, does it say all? Kol, the whole, each and every, all. All. Well, I don't worship our Shecha Hashatana. And we do it all the time, and it costs. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him. They shall bow down in his presence, whose names are not written in the Lamb's book of life, from the Lamb that was slain from the foundations of the earth. They all shall. There's a fallen or temple against the name of Yah. It's a fallen nature. And we better make sure our calling and our election, Yisrael. You will know that by the peri, by the fruit that is coming forth out of you, the wickedness and the ill of what's coming out of us. It is a sure sign that our names are not on top in the bosom of Yeshua HaMashiach. He came to die for that. He is the Sefer. Everything in the book is written of him. He was the book in the first, in the beginning, before that was the beginning. He is the Torah. He is the book. And your name was there. We better make sure that our name is written. We will know that by what governs our mind, the strength of the governing of our mind, and the strength of our right hand. Do we have the blessing, the berakiah, of the right hand of Yah? We will know. We will know Yisrael, and there will be no doubt. He shall cause all, everyone. He's going to call all you damn Jesus thumpers, you Christ Lord God Baal thumpers, all the damn Muslims and the Jews and the Hindus, all of you faith believers, and he calls all of them. How does he do that? He has power. His greatest attack shall be against the Israelite Hiroshim. That's why Yah has granted unto him power, or Yahul. He has granted unto him the power to overcome. With what? If we die, he did not allow Eo to be overcome with death, but we shall be martyred for the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. That's how he's going to overcome us. He shall cause death, Yahshua, granted into his hand for that season, for that period of time, that death shall be in his hand. When he tried to kill you, Eobia says you can't touch him. You can touch everything about him, but you cannot touch his, you cannot touch the Ruach Eob. You cannot touch the life in him. He will not allow the filthy hands of darkness to touch the true testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. Is that in the pinnacle of our minds? Do we think on him? Do we love him? Do we care for him? Our minds are so trained by the powers of hell. Our minds are so easily attracted. Why? Because there's an oath there. We must show our kinsmanship in the form of worship under Hashatan. And it's not about just bowing down and saying, I love you, devil. Damn the devil. It's not about that. Worship is a faithful obedience of action to carry out the prescribed mandate or the strip of what one asks for. It's almost like parents worshiping their sons or their daughters. Whatever they say, they do. Whatever they command, they do. They've esteemed them highly. They'll set them up on a pinnacle. And they can be wicked as hell, they still sit them up. I will, my friend, Tota, for the inspiration. They have set them up above the very standards of Yah. So it's not just about coming and gathering, say we are satanic worshipers. It's not about that. It is how your mind is being trained and the strength of your mind, how it's being utilized for what is the purpose of your left, what is your desire, what is the strength of your Yamiyn, your right hand. He calls them to worship and to bow down. And out of that, as he saw from the loins of Hashatan, he saw this beast, this one that we will call the pseudo-prophet or the false prophet, the anti-Hamashiach. Well, that's just one man. No, it is the spirit of Hashatan that is represented in this man. It is the living substance of the Hashatan that is represented in everyone that has the Uth in their Mesach or in their right hand. And he saw this one rise up in the 13th verse. I want to move because of expedience. Revelation 13:13. He saw this one rise up that had the appearance as though that he was the HaMashiach. He was the Yoshach. He is the one that would save. And caused the standards of darkness to be raised up again. He said he saw this one rise up, this beast. And it says in verse 13, and he does great wonders. When I utilize any form of Greek, it's here. He does great Simeon. It says he does great. It is not the Gadol of Yah. It is the Ra. Not Rab, but Rab. Much abundantly, exceedingly. It says, and he does great wonders, O Simeon. So that he is able to make far come down from Hashemayam upon the Olam in the sight of men. That he has the pretense, the delusion of the eyes of men, that he operates in the same Ruach as Yah, as he caused the fire to come down as Elijah, as Yah with Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. He does, he has the power to perform great miracles in the sight of men. And that's why you see those that are mercenaries of this power of darkness. You see those like Biddy Hen, those like Oral Roberts, those men like Billy Graham, They're the one that set the way for this power of hell. They are the ambassadors of hell. These are the men that establish his strength. And they come from all over the world for Benny Hinn. Men are not teeny snakes, but he's not a small fry in the scheme of things. And he does great Simeon miracles and signs. And he deceives. And he deceives them that dwell upon the earth or in the Olam. By the means of those Simeon, those miracles, which he had power to do in the sight of the beasts. He had power to do it in the sight of Hashatan, for he is his purveyor of strength. He is his power. And that's why we can do things against Yah, because we are dwelling in the presence of the beast. We have the conscience of the beast. We have the mind of the beast. And he calls us to act according to his will and his whim. As long as he was in the presence of the beast, he was able to do that. Yahshua was in the presence of the Abba and all that he did, because he is the living Torah of Almighty Yah. And all that he did, he pleased the Abba. He was the Hafiz. He pleased you on all that he did, Yisra'yah. He is the very Ayin, the very eyes, the very spiritual wisdom of Yah. His word is, Yahshua is that word. It's one thing about the kingdom of hell. A Shatan does not trust. He will not grab that until man. See, man doesn't trust a Shatan. And our Shatan doesn't trust him. There is a contempt one for the other. Everyone will say they hate the devil, or if there's a thing called the devil, they will say that. Yet without the presence, he was able to do that in the sight of the beast. And in this beast that we, a nation, and those, they are doing mighty things. We see those that we think that they are rich in substance, but yet they are poor. We see the gigantuous homes and the cars and the money being spent every day. And the only way they're able to do that, to maintain that, there must be a presence of Hashatan. They must bow. There are nations and countries that are not as far as even the social wickedness as this nation. And they are scraping out of the bottom of the barrel. There are countries and nations that have some kind of a standard of discipline and decency. This nation has no decency. That's why it beckons them from the shores, come to this nation. Come to the house of Hashatan. You can get rich. You can do what you want to. You can be whatever you want to, Yisra'yah. You all didn't establish this for a homeland of Yisra'yah. This came about the greed and the wickedness of man. And because of the rebelliousness of Yisra'yah, he caused many to be shipped to the shores of here, to be indentured in slavery and servants of the wicked ones. Yah has caused that, Yisra'yah. And yet he shows us in the Torah every time that Yisra'yah repented. Did he not bring restitution? I'm not going to let these devils drive me and tell me that I'm cursed with the curse of the Kala of Yah. Because if we read in the book of Devarim, chapter 28, the first 14 verses, where a man obeys that, he has the riches of Yah. He deals with us as a nation. Yisra'yah is a nation of a multiplicity of people. It is a nation of one. You are a nation. You are a nation, Yisra'yah. You will not feed me those damn lies. I'm blessed. Have the Berakai of Yah. Have the life, the strength, the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. I'm strong in Yeshua. HaMashiach can do all things in him. For he's the power of Yah that gives Yisrael strength. That is my testimony of strength. You will not burden me down with that. You can tell others those lies. But with me, you will not bind me in shackles. Because that's what the damn slave masters did. They bound you with those shackles. You will not bind me with that. The slave masters bound those in slavery by the same scripture. By the same kitveh. Hashatan is just slick. He's doing the same thing today. He must seek out, search out, and find those whose name are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's why Herod with Yeshua find the astrologers, the wise men. Tell me of this one that shall come. It must be written in the scrolls. Read it to me. I want to hear about it. And I want you to seek him out and destroy him. And that is the mission of Hashatan. And he doesn't give a damn who he uses. And those who think their skin is blacker than black, that they are the elect of Yah. And that is the only criteria of their identity. You are a damn liar, my friend. And those who think their skin is creamy and white, that they are the elect of Yah. And that's your criteria. You are a damn liar, my friend. I will tow down, my friend. Jodan. I like preaching like this because I get opposition. I will read you some of the statements that individuals wrote me yesterday. That's all right. They're cowardly individuals. They have no strength. They are mature and cowards. That's all they are. They are cowards. Hallelujah. 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 He's able to do it in the sight of the beast. The only way. Was not Herod's government a beast government? Was not his government a beast government? Was not Pharaoh of Mizraim that went forth to destroy the young ones just like in Yeshua's days? Was it not the beast of the government? Was not his government a beast? Was not Dagon the god and the primary god of that kingdom? Did it not look like a vicious, vile, hideous beast? Same thing with Herod. No different at all. And so he is always trying to seek out and to find the true Zira of Yisrael. He doesn't give a damn about the complexion of your skin. He's looking for one thing, for the fruit, for the bearing of the fruit, for the fruit. That's why he's going to be given time to challenge us that he may impregnate our minds with the mark and impregnate our hands to rise up against Yah. That our conscience, our will will rise up against him. That's what he's trying to do. That's why Yah shall give him the Yahul. Yah shall give him the Yahul. He shall give him the power. He shall give him the strength. He shall give him the resolve to overcome us. To overcome. Isn't that beautiful? Why? Because it caused our flesh to die. We're going to have a 45-day period whereby that when we present the offering unto Yah, it's going to, you think that Miriam and they sang. You haven't heard singing yet. Do you hear me? Blessed are those that come to that last 45 day because we're going to sing up. It's not going to be like the five blind boys. They're blind. It's not going to be like this vile thing called Kurt Franklin, these damn devils of hell. It's not going to be like them. But we're going to sing. You understand? We're going to offer up an offering unto Yah. He gave him power to Yahoo. Yahoo what? To overcome what? He cannot overcome the testimony of Yeshua in us to overcome our flesh. Yah's going to destroy. Listen, it is appointed unto every man once to die and then the judgment. We may live, but we must die, Yisrael. This flesh is going to die. Everything about it. There will be no power to rise up. There will be no strength. There will be no mind to resist Yah. There will be no mind to say unto Yah, to blaspheme his name. There will be no strength in one's hands to raise up the sword against Yah. None whatsoever. Glad of it, Yisrael. He's given a power to Yahul. We can see that pattern, that tasneath among Yisrael. Would they rise up? Would he not give the strangers, the enemies, power? Would they not bruise them? Would they not bring them into captivity? Would they not stomp their heads in the ground? This is Yah's plan. That's what we need to understand and learn how to give Torah unto Yah. And stop being so damn sullen. must begin to make a joyful noise unto you. Need to learn how to do that. Hell, we don't do it because we don't give a damn and we don't trust Yah. We just don't trust him. It's a damn shame, Yisrael. Yah. I'm going to say damn. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Not only that, it says, Revelation 13:14, he deceived them that dwell upon the earth by the means of the Simeon, the miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast. And these lying dogs are doing what they call their miracles, Benny Hinn, Oral Robinson, all of them. There is no chronicle of any organic healing by Oral Roberts, Ma'ak. They were vile men. They were adversaries of Yah. They were emissaries of darkness. They had contempt for his name. They despised the Shabbat, the covenant between Yisrael. That's why they led many astray. That's why those that were the true lineage of Yisrael, we become incorporated in the doctrines of hell. I'm a Baptist. What in the hell is a Baptist? I'm a Methodist. I'm a Catholic. Damn a Catholic. I'm Pentecostal. Damn a Pentecostal. Church of the First Brethren. Damn them all. Hallelujah. Gave them power to do miracles we had to do in the sight of the beast. Said to them that dwell upon the earth, he said that they shall make a selim, or an image. He said that they will make an image, a selim, to the beast which had wounded by the sword and did live. And so the testimony of this beast from hell, it shall give life to that. When it give life, he will say, you know, or the spirit of that nature will say, you know, I'm the one who did that. I brought unto you, look at your home, look at your gifts. And that's why people will follow freaks and dogs like Eddie Long, knowing he's a damn faggot. And yet they will oppose me. They will reject me. They will denounce me. But they will listen to a damn freak out of hell like that. That's a pedophile robbing you of the virtue of your sons. They don't give a damn about your daughters. They want your sons. And they will send millions of dollars, and hell, the folks that listen won't even send enough to sustain this. What a damn shame. I'm not taking anything back. Hallelujah. Is that all right? Is this making sense here today? Oh, don't worry about it. I'm going to fill in all the blanks. All today, no, I'll give you an assignment and make you think for next week. But they shall all be filled in. No stone shall be left unturned. We used to hearing this in some kind of dramatization in a way that's, it really doesn't affect us. Oh, okay, that's what Revelation is. Now, we're going to reveal Yeshua. That's what Revelation is. We saw him as the kinsman redeemer. When you see him the next time, he's coming in all hell. He's going to say, I don't give a damn about it. Cut his damn head off. Kill that Jezebel. That bastard. Kill him! We're going to see him in the anger of Yah. He's going to destroy. From one end, he's going to destroy the vengeance of Yah. Look at those tornadoes that's coming through. They destroy everything in their path. And that's the way it's going to be. And it's going to be commanded unto us as the Chidushim that we're going to oversee the restoration of all things, everything. The restoration of Torah life, the restoration of the offerings unto Yah that are pure, the restoration of fellowship, the restoration of Shabbat and the fullness of His beauty. Darkness shall be so on the face of the earth, you will not even see the moon or the sun. How in the hell you going to know how to keep the Shabbat? Because we have the ability in Yah's time that He has granted unto us to number just like He did. He numbered the first day, the second, the third, and the Shabbat. You will not see the sun or the moon. How are you going to do it? How are we going to keep them all dim? And yet He's going to cause such devastation, and we're going to be the ministers to restore that in a 1,000-year reign. whereby the lion shall lie down with the lamb and the lamb with the lion, and they shall go back to their natural state eating grass, and we shall eat the way Yah commanded us. And then after that, then this power of the devious works of hell shall be loose again, and there shall be a consensus man. They will do it. Those that are on the earth at that time, they will do it because they're subjugated. And all of a sudden, this man shall rise up overnight and shall rise up against Yah, and that shall be the ultimate end. And that's the truth, Yisrael. This is not some fairy tale here. This is the truth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He calls men both great, rich, and all to receive a mark in their right hand and in their forehead. The emphasis of this teaching is in the Yamiyn, the right hand. Hear what the word of Yah says. And that no man, he cannot even acquire, he cannot create, he cannot even buy. Your mind will not even be able to create truth. You will not even be able to buy truth. You cannot even buy, you cannot possess, or you cannot even, you cannot even sell. Save he that have the mark, or the name, or the number, that is the manah, the assigned appointed prescription of the beast's name. You will not be able to buy. That's more than just literal food, Yisrael. That is not even that, really. You will not be able to buy truth. They will not be able to buy. And even the West, you will not even be able to sell. You can't even give people truth in that hour. Can you even sell people truth today? You will not be able to buy or to sell. What's that? Mine has been brought unto the captivity of darkness. You will not be able to buy or sell. The nations will not be able to buy. You can't buy truth. You're not going to be able to buy shalom. You're not going to be able to buy any kind of healing. There's nothing you're going to be able to sell. Nothing. Unless you have the mind of the beast. And that is that your right hand, your Yamiyn, and the government of his power rule in your mind. You have embraced all the workings of hell and all the workings of darkness, Yisrael. You have embraced all of that. You're not going to be able to overcome. You're not going to be able to sustain. They're not going to be able to do anything because they're given over unto the kingdom of darkness. But nothing shall come nigh unto those whose names are written. He's going to give him the yahul, the time to try to test us. But we have a testimony that cannot be defied or destroyed. The testimony of Yeshua cannot be destroyed. I don't care what these devils try to do to deny him. He cannot be destroyed. The power of his name cannot be desecrated. You can replace it with your damn Lord Jesus, your damn gods, your damn Baals, your Jehovah Witnesses. You are still damn liars. His name is not going to be eradicated out of the chronicles of man, especially among Yisrael. So you'll not be able to buy and sell. Isn't it that we always think about just, it's all about buying some food or something like that, or those kinds of things. Wickedness shall run rapidly. And every man shall be against every man. Every neighbor, there shall be no trust in no man. Look at some of the large cities. They're stealing, they're killing, they don't have money. But do they buy? Do they get? Come on in Detroit. Come on, someone in Detroit. Folks without money, do they get? Do they have? Sure they do. There will be no form of government. It will be death. We see that today. Cities like Detroit, cities like Baltimore, you call the police, it is a day or two before they come. You call for murder hours before they come. I was talking to Zakin yesterday there in Detroit since the first of the year, and that was the early part of this week. 37 people have died, killed, within the span of neighborhoods. You hear me? 47. You tell me people there, even with the spirit there, they don't steal and take and rob? Hell, they do it all the time. Man pressed against, was not Jean Valjean in prison 20 years. How long did he spend 20 years? For stealing a loaf of bread. If a man steals because he's hungry, Yah said you don't kill the man. If a man is hungry and he steals some bread, you say, man, why you steal my bread? Man, I'm hungry. My babies are hungry. And your compassion says, the mind of Yeshua says, I tell you what you stole, but you're going to pay for that. I want you to work here and help me. Yes, sir. finish the day's work. Here, take this home. Give the man bread and some meat. He weeps. You better be back here tomorrow, man. Yes, sir, I'll be back. He come back, say, well, the next day he's got strength, he works harder. You give more. That his children, his wife, the little bellies are full and fatness on their belly. You don't kill a man when he's still because he's hungry. Man is hungry for bread, you don't kill him. And yet, they will not be able to buy or sell. It's not just food, Yisrael. I'm telling you, it's not that. We must buy Yisrael as a people. We must buy. We must buy the Emat, the truth of Yah, and we must not sell it. Wisdom, understanding, instructions. We must buy that from Almighty Yah. Let me read that quickly. It says in Proverbs 23:23. He tell us the Kana we need to create. He say, buy the truth and sell it not. Also, wisdom, instruction, and understanding. That's what we must buy. We must buy that. They will not be able to buy. And the only way they're going to buy any kind of instruction is because they have the mind of the beast. They've been sealed by that spirit. They've been sealed with the mark in their minds and their yamim. Their strength, they have no strength. They have no power to resist. There is no government, no law. There will be no shafat. How do I know? We are an ignorant, stupid. His people are satish. How do I know? Does Yah show us things, Yisrael? All the time. They killed Mr. Mubarak, didn't they? They brought him down. You don't hear much about Misraim in the papers no more, do you? Because it is a damn wild place. Everyone governs their own community. They govern by their ability to say, boom, 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 baby. No court of laws. None whatsoever. They went in and dismantled that country, did they not? It was a form of some kind of decency and order. And now everybody rules according to their own judgment. You think people are not able, whereby they would not even steal from anyone because they knew that there were retributions for that. Yeah, they cut your hand off. Y'all say you don't cut a man's hands off if he steal. You get caught a second time, then he is indentured to you. Make him work. Make him sweep the floor. And now these countries are lawless. Why you think they're catching hell in Somalia? No government there. They've robbed the country. They destroy the ecosystem. And they say, bring your damn ship. We're going to rob you back, bastards. No law, no government, no government to rule. None. You will not be able to buy or sell unless you have the mark. You will have no counsel. You will have no kind of peace because the darkness and the gloom and the dismal things that are presented unto you. It's gloom and doom, Yisrael. Sun is not shining. The moon doesn't give her light. That's gloomy. It's nothing like a gloomy day. This day is gloomy, isn't it? Dreary. And you imagine that. I don't say that for mockery. I don't care who it is. These massive storms whereby the wind clouds, they have struck. It's gloomy. Everything is cold and it's wet. I don't care who it is. If it's a dog, I would never mark that. If I could do anything to help, I would help. I would not mark that. That's what got Esav in trouble. He mocked Israel and Yehuda. He laughed at them and their calamities and their derision. You don't do that. What matters in derision, you don't do that. You just leave it alone. Don't mess with that. Don't mock him, man. I won't do it. And that's what they did to Yisrael. Oh, they're going down there. Okay. Hallelujah. That's the truth, Yisrael. You can't buy or sell. We can't hardly buy truth today, can we? And try to sell it. Wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. We can't buy that. You're saying that time, the only way we're going to be able to ascertain it, we have the tithe, the mark of assurance. And there's only one mark of assurance in Yisrael. Hallelujah. Can I move a little farther? I want to show you something. There's so much to this. But I'm going to get to a certain point today. And then I'm going to stop. All right? But there's some things that this is going to be profound. When I say profound, it is going to be esoteric. It's going to be so simple that you're going to thump yourself for saying, yeah, that's why we don't read. We don't study. We take no time for Yah. Is that not the truth? Sure, it's the truth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want us to turn quickly to Revelation in chapter 1, verse 16. In the profoundness of this vision that Yochanan saw, he saw the appearance of Yeshua HaMashiach. He perceived him in his ayin, in his uzin, in his eyes, not only in a vision, but he saw him. It says in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 16, he says, I saw something that was so profound. He says, and Yeshua had in his Yamiyn, his right hand. They must take a mark in their forehead and in their right hand. I want to try to establish the significance. We'll get back to the tasnif, the bereshit, of the purpose of the right hand, what it represents. He says, and I saw in his right hand, his Yamiyn, he says, I saw Sheba, seven, the complete perfect order of Yah. I saw seven kochav, seven stars. And out of his mouth, is this the mouth of Yahshua, went forth a sharp two-edged sword. And the countenance of Yahshua was as the shemesh, the sun, with brightness, shining in its strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as a dead man. And look now, the seven stars in his right hand. That's what he had. He saw in his right hand seven stars. When he fell down, Yisraya, when Yochanan fell down as though he was dead, it says this, he laid not his left hand, he laid his right hand, his Yamiyn, upon me, saying, Yirah, fear not. Fear not, he says, saying to me, fear not. He says, I'm the first, I'm the beginning of all judgment, and I am the last. Is that important, his right hand? Was it that we read those words and they have no value to us? Does the Torah teach us what this implies? Why is it that HaShatan must have the Leba, the mind, and the Yamiyn? Why the right hand? Why the right hand? Why could it not be the left shoulder? So is that vital? Should we understand when we see things like that? Should we get wisdom of that matter? Yeah. Wisdom is the principal thing, is it not? Yeah. But in all of our understanding, our getting, let us get understanding, let us get benar. What? To discern, to know. To have revelation of the matter, to understand the actuality and all of that which is a part of that matter. We must understand all things. He had the seven kochav stars in his right hand. They have to be vital. It must represent a very vital importance to Yisrael. Yochanan, as he felt as though that there was maveth, that he died prematurely, he laid his right hand on him. I like this here. I'll get to it. Keep your thinking. Keep you anticipating and eager, willing. Well, I can rush into it. I'm not going to do that. You can't bake a nice cake just throwing something together and trying to hurry up. You got to take your time. When you take your time, you know it's going to be right. You're doing it with love. Then you say, oh, when I finish this here, it's going to be tough. You got to take your time. You can't cook an excellent meal by rushing. You're angry. You're upset. You take your time. You set that oven right. Right temperature. Is it warm enough? You know it's got to be right temperature. Can't put it in now. Got to be 350 degrees before you put it in. Can't be 250, baby. Turn that oven on. Let it wait a little while. Mama, the light's on. It's hot. That's all right. Just don't worry about it, baby. And she's going to make sure it's 350. 15, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. She says, 350 now. Now's the time. Now, you all don't go opening that oven now. You didn't open the oven door. Can be the slightest drop in temperature. Isn't it amazing I know that kind of stuff? You also don't walk in that kitchen. I'm walking. You cause that cake to fall. You're not going to trample on the dam of Yeshua HaMashiach like we've done. You can forget that. And so everything was quiet because that cake, when it came out, it looked pretty. She took that thing out of that pan. She said, no, let it cool off a little bit, baby. Don't mess with it. Mama, don't mess with it. When she brought it out, boy, oh, so beautifully brown. The parents just, man, just, you wanted a piece of that. All you could do is just look at it. And when she took that pan off, there was no crumbs there, even in there. The little piece got stuck in there. She, oh, baby, oh, mama got to fix this. And fix that bad boy, put a little icing on there. Talk to me, Israel. Yah's going to fix it. Oh, he's going to fix it. After a while, I know Yah will fix it for me. Oh, I know Yah. Oh, he will. Oh, he will fix it for me. Oh, he will. If I live right as he commands, oh, I live by the Torah of Yah. I know that Yah, will fix it every time. Oh, he will. You see, I do that to get you out of your own rhythm. Your rhythm isn't worth a damn. It has never paid off. Hallelujah. Oh, I know how to sing it. I know how Sam Cooke. I used to like to hear Sam Cooke. He didn't sing nothing over 3 minutes. 2 minutes, 15 seconds, less than 2 minutes. You never hear a song of Sam Cooke over 3 minutes. Stop it. Hallelujah. He had in his right hand, listen, Revelation 5:1. He says, Yokohan says, and I saw in his Yomi the strength of who? Of him. Of Almighty Yah, that sat on the Kiseh, on the Kiseh, the throne of power. He had it in his right hand, not his left. It is right hand. Shall cause all rich, poor, great, mighty to take the mark of the beast and man in the leba and their right hand. There is an assault, there's a purpose behind all, whether it is figurative speech. We will show you the truth of this figurative speech if it is, all right? He saw the one sit on the throne, Yah, with this great scroll. It was written inside, within, and on the backside. And listen, it was sealed with seven seals. Our minds must be sealed with the seals of Yah. You know what those seven seals are? I will tell you. Don't worry. I will tell you what those seven seals are. Your mind must be sealed with the seven seals of Yah. Your heart must be sealed. It's one thing when granny hid some money or something like that, they had that thing, they had it hid. When they didn't have it up here pinned to that chest, to their shaft, they could feel it. And granddad had that money hid, boy, it would take you, you had to have a perfect, even a mind of a thief couldn't find it. That is, you say, what's my Zochin? Say it again. Can't fuss at you too much. Say it loud. That's right. The hellish of thieves can find it. The most damnable dogmatic thieves could not find that. Is HaShatan a thief? He had seven seals on the book. Are our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life? There are seven seals. There are seven guarding powers that guard it. Oh, you know what it is. You trying to seek and reason in these damn corrupt minds. You cannot reason this. Must be revealed. He saw in the hands of Yah a book with seven seals. It was written. So why was written within without? Why? Because there's nothing else that could be added. You're not going to add anything. No one is going to add anything. You can't interpret it. That's what it was. It was sealed. It was sealed. Backside sealed with seven seals. And then he saw a strong Malach, not no effeminate man. These damn effeminate men like to look faggot looking. Azar King Yarabaya taught us that these women, how that we're so naked today. Men are naked, the women are naked, the daughters are naked whores. I would not even let a naked whore come in my presence like that. I never forget her natural sister. She was a shapely gal back then. I mean, she was shapely. The woman was shapely. Waistline so small, come on. That's what men look for, buttocks and titties. And she came in my presence one day, and I was an ignorant man. She came to my house. She never came back again that way. When I finished with her, mama back there pulling up that cloak to keep her shoulders warm, she was trying to find something to cover her nakedness before me, and the tears just began to flow. You understand? And even to this day, she knows. Well, she called herself her own woman, but there are certain men that women won't challenge and try. You understand? When I finished, she covered herself. Her shame covered her. There was a strong milak, not these effeminate boys. He stood up proclaiming with a karachua, with a loud voice, with a voice that was so piercing. He said, who is worthy to open the shefah and to loose the seals? Everything that Yah has contemplated, it is done, and it is done by his wisdom. It is not. He is the orchestrator of all things, Yisrael, his might, his strength, his power. Who can stand up in the presence of Yah? Yokohan said, no man, no one in Hashemaam, not Elijah, not Moshe, no man in the Olam or under the earth, there was none that could be raised up, was able to open the stole or to look on it. There is no man that is able to bring forth the revelation of Yah and Yeshua. Only the testimony of Yeshua does that, Yisrael. I don't give a damn if you dig Abraham up out of the grave today, his bones, if you could find him. They cannot bring the revelation of Yah. You could get Yitzchak, Yaakov, Obadiah, none of them. Not even the Melech, the Melechim of Hashemayim can. Only one man, Yeshua. Power that testimony. That's why our minds cannot fathom, it cannot understand the power of that unearthly thing rising up, born out of an Oma. Come on, Yisrael. Defies all nature. That doesn't come by the revelation of a man. It doesn't come by the intuition or the wisdom of a man. It comes by the knowledge of Yah. Yah cannot understand this. Yah had to reveal it. Come on. He taught the power of Yah and Yeshua, but until he saw the revelation of Yeshua HaMashiach, only then could he teach you with great power, ferociousness, fearlessness. We must see him. Not waiting to get into Hashemam. I want to see him now. Look upon him. How do we see him? By the fruit of his power in Yisrael. We're so full of deception. His right hand. His Yamiyn. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And no man was able to open the scroll to look on it. He says, and I began to weep much. Not even him. Not even Shaul. Not even Kephah. He said, I began to weep much. Because no man was found worthy to open and to read the scroll, neither to even look therein. That's why no man can look in the Torah of Yah and find wisdom and revelation. It must come by the power of the testimony of Yeshua. If any man calls himself a prophet or a messenger of Yah, and if he speaks not according to the Torah, if he speaks not according to the Torah of Yah and the Edu, the testimony, It is because there is no power of light, the oil, or the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach in him. None whatsoever. So no man can speak of the power. No man is worthy to bring revelation of the Torah of Yah unless there's a revelation of the testimony of Yahshua. And when that man does, he falls and he weeps before Yah because he knows that he is unworthy. These are arrogant damn beasts today. These are arrogant, immature, pompous, little, unclean nerds today. They don't know a damn thing. You find them by the tens of thousands. There are tens of thousands of young men out there thinking that they are prophets and leaders and all of that. And they may have them and their wife or someone else. And that's all it's going to be. Come on, look, I've been preaching a long time. Look at this crowd. Osteen, I said to my Israel, that 19,000 people every service he have. The only man that has ever preached in that whole house was T.D. Jakes. He never let no other man preach there. No other man he allowed to preach in there. T.D. Jakes, we've overwhelmed that. He has more in one service than T.D. Jakes has in his whole house in two services. 19,000. I've seen the place what he has. We went to Houston. It was a basketball arena. And they have literally hundreds and hundreds of wheelchairs. That was the first thing I noticed when I went. I said, wow. Hundreds of wheelchairs. Not only the folks does he cripple the folks naturally, he cripples them spiritually. Hallelujah. And you had all these wheelchairs where the folks were crippled. That's what for the folks that are crippled. They're crippled spiritually and they're crippled naturally. That's just a fact. Hallelujah. No man was able to open this book, but he cried. And no man was found. And verse 5, and one of the Zachin, said to him, he says, Bacha, weep not. Don't have such grief, bewailing, lamenting, and weeping so bitterly. He says, weep not. He said, let Yah open your eyes. He says, behold, Eri, the lion. Eri, the lion of Uma Yehuda, and the Shiresh, or the root of David, he has prevailed. How? In death. Even death could not hold him. There had just been the power of a mere man to raise him up, he would have still been in the grave. So that was something. He has prevailed. What? Over death, over sin, over the power of Hashatan, over the images that he presented unto him, showed him the kingdoms, bow down to me, worship me, I will give this unto you. He has prevailed. He has risen. He has risen in the power of Yah. He has prevailed. He says to Shalach, to open, to make known, to open, and to loose the seven seals thereof. And he said, and I look, and in the midst of the Kesei, the four beasts, that represents the governing of the four corners of the earth. The four spirits of Yah. Yah represents. That governs what? Yah says, if a prophet be deceived, Yah has deceived. Yes. I will send forth a lying spirit into the mouth of the prophet, that he will lie and they will believe a lie. So he has, and he uses the word behemoth, or behemoth, this beast, or the power of one, a beast. You're scared of a beast. You understand? You say what you want to. You're not just running out there in that field with the cow, with one of them big bulls, 1,500 pounds, and call yourself running up on him. You're not going to do that. Okay, how brave you are. Because he began to... You're looking for someone to run, and you can't outrun him. Okay, how fast you are. You may dash up in a tree. You better stay there until he's going to say... I remember one day I went over there to butcher and to knock a bull out. I don't like doing that. I get my boy back there to do it. He knocked him up. Boom. And so this bull, when I laid the first one right here, I come down, boom, boom, right on the money. He didn't even drop. Blood began to spew out of his nose and everything. Sure, this big bull, I don't know which one it was. The big one, the last one, he said, they like that. Even though they would fight all the time, those bulls would lock horns and they would fight. So I got positioned again and I hit him here. Boop. He still didn't go. I said, oh man, this is a beast here. So when I hit him again, boom, I got him right. He went down like. And when that bull saw that, all the heifers just gathered around him, trying to pick him up. When that bull saw that, he looks at me and he said, started digging. So I said, oh boy, I'm gonna have to drop. I will drop. You going down in the meat pot. I started running, well, because my knees were hurting. I didn't feel him. And I said, I'm not gonna let you. And then I saw the ladder, the head over there where they hunt. I said, if I try climbing that, man, that ladder can't hold me. So I ran, he right on me now. And I ran behind the tree. I'm like, whoa, no way he's gonna get me this way. I said, boy, if he had come any further, he would have been stew beef and hamburger. Because I was gonna let him gorge me like that, and he would have killed me. You understand? And that's the nature of a beast. The spirit of this beast is gonna try to gorge Yah, Joshua, to kill his name, to destroy it, to destroy it out of the earth. He said, look at the message that can't say four beasts, those that govern the four corners of Yah's domain. And in the midst of the Zochin, he says, stood a Sith, a Seth, a Lamb, Yahshua. In the midst of all of that, in the midst of Yisrael being scattered to the four corners, Yahshua stands in the midst. He said, as though he had been harach, killed, slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven rachim of Yah, sent forth into all the Olam Yisrael. You are not going to overcome this beast unless Yahshua HaMashiach lay his right hand on you. And when he laid his right hand on Yakahan, he imparted the power of the seven Ruachim of Yah. I'm going to read that. We've been taught that here. He was imparted with that seven Ruachim. That's why the Torah teaches, he said, they shall not be able to buy or to sell. If you don't have this, you're not going to be able to buy this. And no one is going to be able to sell you this Yisrael. That's why we buy the truth now, wisdom, knowledge, and understand. You don't sell truth, Yisrael. No man is going to be able to buy it. You're not going to be able to buy it. The wicked can't buy it. They have not this to sell. Hell, bread, they will get bread. They will rob and take bread. Are they not doing it in Iraq? No government. The nations that have been destroyed by this Arab Spring that America said it would be, you don't hear anything about them. The only one you hear is Syria. Because they want to destroy that. They know that they can go in smooth, halak, slippery and flattered of people. Democracy, you all can get rich and steal their substance. They're of their father, the devil. They have been impregnated in their minds by their daddy, the devil. And these men of mercantile, they don't give a damn about anyone's nephesh. They kill, they rob, they steal, they pillage, they take advantage. That's why America doesn't like China and Russia, because China, they have not had the business practice of these wicked bastards here in America. They will go to the continent of Africa and say, look, this is what we will do. We don't want your oil. We will buy every drop of it. Nigeria. British petroleum go there and say, we take every damn thing. We give you 10%. And pay the cronies. Segregate their communities where they are guarded by paid thugs that they pay them. Give them money. Make sure their babies, they have a little shack they can live in. They got money. They got guns. They take, they extort. And these bastards rob the countries, will not build schools, will not build medical facilities. China says, I tell you what, you're talking about, just for an example, you're talking about a million barrels of oil a day. You sell us 800,000 barrels a day. at market's price. What we will do, we will build your infrastructure, we'll build your roads, we got to get the oil. We'll build your highway, we will build all your super infrastructure, your infrastructure. We will charge you to do this, we're going to charge you $18 billion. We give you a 30-year loan at 3%. Based on the fact that you sell us your oil at 3% below market value of oil value. So they both come out on the right end. And that's why they're trying to dismantle China. And that's why this nation doesn't speak highly of China, because that's how they do it. They don't go and rob the people like the British and the Englishmen. And they don't do that. Like America, the greedy bastards want everything. They said, we will build your schools, we will send teachers here. As long as we can set up our shop, the hell they're going to sell them the China wares and all that, folks come back. And you will find the population of the Chinese outstripping the folks of the land. Then you will find them renting the hectare acres by the millions, and they're growing food, shipping it back to China. That's how they do it, Israel. But not this wicked nation. I'm going to find me a spot to close here. I want to point out something here before I do. Turn quickly to Yeshua. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The seven Ruachim of Yah. Seven seals. These are the seven seals of Yah. And this is what must govern our minds, what guard our minds. Yeshua 11:1, Isaiah. He said, and there shall come forth. Let me ask you this question. Was there any guile in Yahshua? Did he sin? Did he walk wickedly? Did he comply in all Torah? Did he not come to fulfill all Torah? He had to have the substance of Yah, had to have the mind. He will see with the seven ruachim of Yah. It says this. There shall come one forth, or yatsa. He shall be brought out of a rod, out of the stem of the stock of Yasha. A branch shall grow, shall para. When a branch grow, it brings forth fruit. He shall bring forth fruit. Are we not the branches of Yahshua HaMashiach? We are the true branches and we bring forth fruit. He said, out of the stem of Yesha there shall grow a branch. And the word branch, para, is one that bears fruit. And if we are not bearing fruit, we are not the branch, Yisrael. He said, and he shall grow, he shall para, out of his roots. Then he identifies. He said, first of all, and the ruach of Yah, the ruach hachodash, the spirit of Yah shall rest upon him. It shall nuach, it shall settle on him, fill his bosom. The ruach, the spirit of Yah shall rest upon him, that's one. The ruach of chukmah, that's two, the skillful practice of spiritual battle and warfare, defending the kingdom. What? The kingdom of Yah's mind, his tav in us, his seal in us. He shall have the ruach of chukmah, wisdom, two. Also the ruach of binah. He has the power to discern when Yah says move, when Yah says stand still, when Yah says get up, when Yah says be quiet. He has that power. He has the power of binah. There are the three ruachim. These are the three of the seals of the book. The book, the whole book is written of Yahshua HaMashiach, isn't he? Isn't it? We are the book. The story of the life of Yahshua is written in us. And those seals are our mind, Yisrael. Those ruachim. He said, not only that, the ruach of binah, understanding, where one can discern, also the ruach of atzah, of counsel, Yisrael. And we need to understand the advice of Torah. The purpose of Yah must be in us. Also the ruach of gebrah, of a warrior, of a mighty one that's strong. We must be strong. We must bear up our loins with strength. This battle that's ahead, you can't be weak if you think you're going to win. We're not winning today. We're losing. And the enemy is gaining ground. You understand? He said also the ruach of da'at, the ability that when one discerns, it is by the skillfulness of understanding. These are the seals of Yah, that when he places right hand on us, and I will tell you what it does. Hallelujah. And also the fear or the yira of Yah, the seven ruachim, the terrifying, awesome reverence we have of Yah in his presence, when we see him, when he dwell among us, that there's a great reverence of fear about Yah. We must have that Yisrael. And if we don't have that, woe unto us. We must. We must keep that alive. And without the seal of the Rechem of Yah in our mind, then the doors open unto the enemy to inscribe that which that he will take strength in our right hand. And it simply implies this: we will sell our birthright, the right to the knowledge of his wisdom, his understanding, the fear of Yah. That's why folks don't fear Yah. That's why they don't understand Torah. It is the selling of one's birthright. And we will bring that out in greater detail next week. I want to close with that, but let me read this. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is the selling of one birthright. That's what it's all about. That's what the right hand. The right hand, and we will see that when we go to the Tasnith. It is the power to bestow the riches of the blessing upon the firstborn. Are we not the firstborn of Yah in Yeshua? And I will explain all that next week, all right, on next Shabbat. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The last Ruachim that he speaks of is the Yireh of Yah. The fear of Yah, the terrifying awesomeness. And one of the most profound messages must be preached in this day, in this hour. And I want to close with this today. It is found in Revelation chapter 14, verse 6. Hallelujah. And 7. This is the true end time message of this time. Yochanan said, I saw another Melech flying in the midst of Harshimaim. In the midst of Harshimaim. He said, in this one that I saw, Yisrael, he had the everlasting, or the Olam V at the everlasting Bizurach, or the message to preach. It says this is the everlasting message. This is the most permanent message to preach. The everlasting message to preach. To them that dwell where? In the Olam or on the earth? Does it say that? To how many nations? To some or every nation? To every nation. This is what's supposed to be preached to every nation. To every kindred, to every tongue, and to every people. This is what must be declared. Saying with a loud voice, fear Yah. Is that the detraction of what Christianity and others teach? You don't fear him, it doesn't mean that. This is the message. Fear Yah. Give honor to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. It has entered in. And Shahar, worship him that made Hashemayim and Olam and the sea and the fountains of the water. This is the message of this hour. We must yare, we must yara, yira. We must fear Yah. And if we do not, if we have not the seal of the seven ruachim of Yah, if Yahshua has not laid his right hand, and we will understand that next Shabbat in a greater detail, then we shall sell our birthright like Esau, that fornicator, that profane, wicked individual. And when we try to find a place of repentance, you shall never find one. So once you're given unto this seal of darkness, there is no repentance. There's no repentance. And you cannot understand that unless we go back to the Tasnith. We must understand all things. I'm going to stop there. May the riches of Yah rest upon you, called Yisrael Yah. May he strengthen you all. May he cause you to be fat. And we're going to get fat in the Shabbats to come on this. Hallelujah. Let us stand to our feet. Hallelujah. He lives. Because he lives, we can face tomorrow. As we turn toward Yerushalayim here, you and your homes, we barak you for all things, Yah. For your excellent, the power of your might. We told you for Yisrael Yah scattered abroad throughout the nation, strengthen, heal, set free. Give us wisdom and understanding. Cause our hearts to delight in your Torah. We bind every demon of hell. Heal those that need healing. We pray for them that are in need of healing, Yah. We ask your healing upon them in Yahshua's mighty name. Strengthen Yisrael Yah and all those, Yah, that need healing. In Yahshua's name, this day, grant unto us life, your will, that we may esteem you highly above all things. In Yahshua's mighty name, with our voice we cry, hallelujah. 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 Amen. Yabarak. Shalom Yisrael.